this earth. And God has called us, like I said earlier, to live at this time. And so if you see, turn in the Word to 1 John chapter 4, 14. And 1 John chapter 4, 14, it says, we have seen and testified that the Father has sent His Son to be the Savior of the world. And then John 3, 16, how many of you know John 3, 16 by heart? For God so loved the world, He gave His only Son. Whoever puts his trust in God's Son will not be lost, but will have life that lasts forever. So why do we need a Savior? Have you ever thought about it? Why is it important that we acknowledge that there's a God and that we make Jesus the Lord of our lives? Why are these things important? Have you ever heard the question, is there really a God? If so, if there's really a God, why did He send His Son to die? And so these are questions that almost everyone I know has asked sometime in their life. Why do you need a Savior? And what is He saving me from? And if we look at John 3:16, it tells us our why. It tells us why we need a Savior. For God so loved the world that He gave His one and only Son, that whoever believes in Him shall not perish, but have eternal life. So God so loved. And you could actually say it, so God so loved me. So God so loved you, right? The most important thing to remember about God is that He loves you. Say that with me. God loves me. God loves me. God loves you. And it was that love that set into motion a plan so that He could save the world. 1 John 4, 16 tells us that God is love. Whoever lives in love lives in God and God in them. And love is that force that drove God into sending His Son. What does that mean? It means that God loves you. He's always loved you, and He always will love you. No matter what you do, God loves you. No matter how many times you screwed up, God loves you. Has anybody besides me ever screwed up before? Right? And sometimes we live messed up lives, and we're broken, and we're messed up, and we're wrecked, and here's our lives, and it's all a mess, but God still loves you.
Amen.
Thank you, Father.
In spite of your mess, in spite of your junk, and in spite of your garbage, God still loves you. And I just thank God, because that's His mercy, and that's His grace that speaks to me every day of my life. Have you ever been in a situation where it just seemed like there was no way out?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, me too. But you know what? Connect to the One that has a way out.
Amen.
Of what you're going through.
Thank you, Father.
For God so loved the world. You know, when we're dealing in relationships with people, they can get sticky, they can get messy, and they can get heartbreaking. God understands all of that. And He has a way of getting you from point A to point B. Listen, I can't get from point A to point B by myself. I can't get there. But with God's help and with God's love, right, all things are possible through Him that loves them. Amen?
Amen.
Amen. Praise God. And so He tells us that love is what compelled Him to set up this plan. It's called the plan of salvation. So that you can have an intimate relationship with Him. And if you want to be in the plan, if you want to, the plan includes eternity. Never dying but living with God forever. Have you ever thought about it, that you're going to live forever? That's why you need to make up your mind where you're going to live. You can live with God or in the other place. Now, you know, if we went through some really, really hot summer this year, triple-digit weather, 105, 110, you know, those days remind me that I don't want to go to the other place. You know what I'm saying? I want to be, I imagine
steal, kill, and destroy. And he'll steal whatever you let him steal, whatever you don't take authority over. But Jesus says that I have come that you might have life, and life more abundantly. Satan steals, kills, and destroys. Jesus gives life. Amen. So in a nutshell, we've answered, why would God send his son? He sent his son for love of you. And then you have to decide whether or not you believe in God. Now, you might be asking the question, why should you? Well, maybe a better question might be, why wouldn't you? Why wouldn't you believe in the God who made the universe? Why wouldn't you believe in the God who hung the stars in the sky? Why wouldn't you believe the God who created everything in it? You know, when I go, I like to camp, I like to go on drives, and have you ever done that? You're driving along, you see the mountains, you see the trees, you see how beautiful everything is, and when I look at the beauty of nature and think about how intricate and precise everything functions, it says to me that there is a creator.
Amen.
That there's a God.
Amen.
You know, have you ever been to the Grand Canyon and you go down and you see it, and it's just vast and beautiful, and it's bigger than you are, and you just look around and you go, surely there has to be a God that created all this splendor and all this beauty. There is a God. Amen? And he created you and he created me. When we look at our bodies, and if you ever go in for a checkup, and they talk about how your body functions and how intricate and precise every part of your body is, and it works together, why wouldn't I believe in God? The God who created me. The God who created the universe. Psalm 95 says, come, let us sing to pour joy to the Lord. Let us shout aloud to the rock of our salvation. Let us come before him with thanksgiving and extol to him with music and song. For it is the Lord, is the great God, the great King above all gods. In his hands are the depths of the earth, and the mountain peaks belong to him. The sea is his, for he made it, and his hands formed the dry land. Come, let us bow down and worship. Let us kneel before the Lord our Maker, for he is our God, and we are the people of his pasture, the flock under his care. So the question is here. God, you know, the question of God, for me, I've never struggled with it. But I know that people have struggled with it. But I don't know why I've never struggled with it. Just because I was taught at a very young age that God is, and he was, and that he loves me. But some people don't have the benefit of that. They grew up in a household where their parents didn't talk about the love of God or didn't show them the love of God. nobody could contact us, and we couldn't contact, and that was the time when you did this thing, you got a piece of paper, and you wrote it out, and it's called a letter. Y'all remember letters, and we put a stamp on it, and mailed it, and we mailed it, and you know, we take 2-3 weeks to get a letter from home, and then we take 2-3 weeks for them to get a letter for us. It literally felt like we were so isolated, and we were. Well, while we were there, my husband was on a softball team, and one of his friends owned a motorcycle, and he was in the softball game, his friend, and he hurt his knee, and he could not ride his motorcycle back to his home. And so that day, you know, we had a discussion, and I wasn't really serving God. I was doing my own thing. Have you ever done your own thing? Yeah, me too. I know it's hard for you to believe, but yeah, I was doing my own thing, not listening to God, just, you know, trying to raise my kids, and thought I had all the answers to work all life's issues out, but I didn't realize that I did. Anyway, Ross wanted to get on this motorcycle, and I just felt an impression from the Holy Spirit, do not let him get on the motorcycle. So I stood there for an hour talking to Ross. I really believed God. And I didn't really have the language that I have right now. You know, I was young and so not really following the Lord. I said, I just don't think we should get on this motorcycle. I feel like something bad is going to happen. Brenda, it's okay. I've ridden motorcycles before. That's not the issue. Ross, just don't get on this motorcycle. So he gets on the motorcycle and listens to me. Gets on the motorcycle. And I'm following him back to our house. Well, you can imagine how traffic is in Turkey. It's really crazy. Everybody, there's rules, but there's not rules, you know? And so everybody drives everywhere, and they pass you up, and they come at you on the wrong side of the road. Well, anyway, Ross passed me on the motorcycle, and then a bus was coming from him on the wrong side of the road. He swerved to miss the bus. And when he swerved, as he was going around the curve, he lost control of the motorcycle, and now he's down on the ground. So I was right behind him, he stopped, and I tell promise. Remember your promise. Remember your promise. I think for each and every one of us, it gets to a time where we have to surrender everything that we have once and for all to the Holy Spirit. So what's he going to take once and for all? That was me, once and for all. That was me. I made that promise. It was a couple of years later, and then I started to keep my promise to God. Have you promised God something? Keeping your promise to God. Keeping yourself in God's presence. You know, Psalm 89:26, he says, he will call out to me. You are my Father, my God, my rock. You know, God called out to me. After I made that promise, he started calling me. And he said, Brenda, that promise that you made me, I've got something for you. I want you to keep it. I want you to come to me. I want you to listen to what I have to say. And then one day, a couple of years later, I decided that I was going to keep my promise to God. And I want to tell you, I've been serving God ever since. And he is a good God. He is God our Father. He's the one we cry out to. We cry out to him because he's our Lord. He's the creator of the universe. He's our God. He's our Father. He's our rock. And he's our Savior. Amen. Deuteronomy 36:6. Be strong. Be courageous. Do not be afraid or terrified because of this. For the Lord your God goes with you. He'll never leave you. He'll never forsake you. I love this scripture. It comforts me. It speaks to me. It encourages me. And it lets me know that I'm not alone. And you may be feeling like you're alone right now and that you don't have anybody around you or anybody that cares for you. And I just want to let you know right now that that's a lie from the pit of hell, because God loves you, he cares for you, and he's there. And if you just ask him, just like me, 28-year-old kid in Germany all by myself, his presence surrounded me. Praise God. And his presence will surround you. There's no situation that's too difficult for God. There's nothing that you have done that God can't make himself real to you. God is a real God, loves me, cares about me. And I encourage you today to allow God to make himself real to you. And I know he will. Why? Because he loves you. So, why do we need a Savior? What is it about us that needs to be saved? The very definition of Savior is one who delivers or rescues. What do we need to be delivered or rescued from? Well, if you look at 2 Timothy 3:1-4, it says, but mark this, there will be terrible times in the last days. People will be lovers of themselves, lovers of money, boastful, proud, abusive, disobedient to their parents, ungrateful, unholy, without love. Savior. We need a Savior to save us from the things that separate us from God. The things that separate us from God, those actions, that's called sin. And we need a Savior to save us from our sins. The part of us, it's the part of us that wants to destroy. It's the part of us that wants to tear down, sabotage any good in our life because it just takes too much effort. God sent his son so he could have a relationship with him and enter into a place where his love can live in you. 1 John 4:14 in the Message says, everyone who confesses that Jesus is God's son participates continuously in an intimate relationship with God. We know it so well. We've embraced it heart and soul. This love that comes from God. God wants you to participate in a relationship with him. There is a God. He has a son. His name is Jesus. He came to earth. He took up a cross. He willingly gave his life. He took back what the devil stole, and he rose again. His name is Jesus, and he wants to be your Savior if you let him. So I'm going to read John 3:16 in the Message. It's today's language. And I like the Message because it speaks to me. It speaks Texan. That's what I like to say. This is how much God loved the world. He gave his son, his one and only son, and this is why, so that no one need be destroyed. By believing in him, anyone can have a whole and lasting life. God didn't go to all the trouble of sending his son merely to point an accusing finger, telling the world how bad it was. He came to help, to put the world right again. And anyone who trusts in him is acquitted. Anyone who refuses to trust in him has long since been under the death sentence without knowing him. And why? Because of that person's failure to believe in the one-of-a-kind Son of God when introduced to him. You know, 2 Peter 1:3, it tells us that he has given us his divine power for everything we need for a godly life. God gave us everything when he gave us his son, Jesus. And so many years ago, it is that power, that resurrection power, that transforms us and changes us and makes us better than what we were. transformation like this can only take place with a real encounter with the Savior, the one who defeated death and rose again. Peter knew all too well his thoughts, his faults and imperfections. He knew that he had failed Jesus when he needed the most. He messed up. And so he decided, I'm just going to go back, and I'm just going to do what I do. And he started fishing again. Then, one day, the most wonderful thing happened. The Lord appeared on the beach and said, come on, Peter, come eat breakfast with me. So they did, and Jesus turned to Peter and said, do you love me? And Peter said, yes, Lord. And Jesus said, then feed my sheep. Then he asked Peter a second time, and Peter answered again, yes, Lord. And Jesus said, then feed my sheep. And finally, a third time, Jesus said, Peter, do you love me? And Peter said, yes, Lord. And Jesus said, then feed my sheep, canceling out every time that Peter had denied him. Peter allowed the love of God to cleanse him and change him to the point that 50 days after the crucifixion of Jesus on the day of Pentecost, Peter had taken to the streets and challenged all those who were present for the death of Jesus. What a changed life. Peter changed so much that he became the rock of the church that Jesus spoke about in Matthew 16, 18. And I tell you that you are, Peter, on this rock I will build my church, and the gates of hell will not overcome it. That is Peter's transformation. He's the leader of the church. He was outspoken, bold, and courageous, and God used him to lead and guide the church in its earliest beginnings. He used Peter to be bold and outspoken because the church needed someone so strong. He used Peter to bring unity to a body in a time when the church could have been so easily destroyed. That was a transformative life, a life that was suddenly different because one word from God can change your life. So Peter allowed his life to be changed. He allowed his life to be changed so much that when the end of his life came, he too was crucified, only in Rome. It is said that Peter chose to be crucified upside down because he was not worthy to be crucified in the same manner as our Lord. What a difference in this man who's frightened and scared in the very beginning, and what a difference in the life of Peter when he encountered the Jesus, the Son of God, and he allowed God to change him. So he answered the call that day on the beach. Peter answered the call when Jesus asked him to feed his sheep, and he said, yes, I'm so glad I did. Because Peter allowed his life to be changed, he changed the world, and because his world was changed, that change has affected all of us to this day. We serve a God that has given us the divine power to produce change in all of us. And you have a decision each and every day to be that changed life that changes the world. And I encourage you to allow God to speak to your heart. And those things that you've been holding back, don't allow them to keep you from your potential that God has for you. And give your all to Jesus, just like Peter did so many years ago, and allow God to use you to change your world. So today I've talked to you about Jesus, the Son of God, and I want to give you the opportunity of allowing him into your heart. You know, Romans 10:9 says, if you declare with your mouth Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you will be saved. Mm-hmm. It's just that simple. So you would like to ask Jesus in your heart, then let's say it together. Let's just bow our heads and say it together. And just believe and pray with me. Jesus, I ask you to be my Savior and Lord. And forgive my sins. I ask you to take my life and do something with it. Amen. And now it begins. If you meant that prayer and you believe in your heart that God raised him from the dead, you're saved. That's salvation. And with your whole being, you embrace God setting things right. And you say it, that God has set everything right between me and him. Amen.